you were there first.
Okay.
Mr. Marshall. See you this afternoon. Couple of things. I have not read the solid story, but there's been some issues raised about the Redskin site that's been proposed about environmental. I had a couple of constituents call me and say there's a possibility of contamination on the site. Has soil boards been done on the site to determine what is actually there?
It's my understanding that the State Department of General Services has done environmental testing on the site, not just for this project, but in advance of this project, because they were looking at it for other uses. And they didn't find anything.
They did not find anything.
Would prevent this type of use.
That would prevent this type of use. So the building can be constructed, the fields can be constructed, and we're not dealing with environmental issues.
That's my understanding.
That's your understanding. Okay. All right. I'm sure it's going to be asked again. The second thing is that last week at Finance, I asked for a complete breakdown of where all the projects are, what's going on, how we're going to do this in relationship, and I have not seen that information yet.
Okay, council member, I'm going to have Mr. Raker have to bring that right now. We provide a quarterly report to council for all projects. The most recent report I could do this week. I've asked that he bring me the report. I think he might answer it. That's going to
change. Imagine that.
Shot.
We're shot.
All right, I do.
Okay, because that's very helpful. Will that also give me the projections? Will Mr. Harris also have projections out for the cycles on CIP for the 5 years? So, because as you and I both know, the 2015 year is a critical year in terms of our capital borrowing. That's where we come closest to hitting one of the governors on our spending limits.
That analysis is done as we go through the budget process, so we're not at that point yet. He can tell you what the report will show you is for each project, what's been appropriate today, what's been and what has been spent today, and what the balance is.
Right.
And it'll tell you the date the project started.
The other question that I've asked is where are we in relationship to the capital expenditures that are required for the 2015 cycle works? I know there's been a lot of conversations about improving roads, improving sidewalks, things of that nature. And I've asked on several occasions, where are we in terms of capital costs associated with this race, which we committed to doing? And I'm glad we're there, but at the same time, I think it has an impact on our capital spending.
If you recall, you asked me that question, but I'll tell you where we are as best I can. If you recall, in the 13 and 14 capital budgets, there were dollars appropriated for the race. Capital dollars appropriated for the race. We have a total roadway budget, I believe in 13, of $5 million. And another $1 million on top of that for other improvements associated with the race. Most of those expenses will be seen in the spring, or after January. So it really is a spring fiscal year. It's still fiscal year 13, but it's the 14 paving. So you'll see that over all next year and the following year. In the 14 budget, in addition to the $5 million we have in for roadways, we also have an agreement with the state for another $5 million to make this money. So that $5 million will go to 10. We've identified the areas around the routes, the route itself, plus one block on each side of that route, and have already done the needs analysis. So we believe we have sufficient dollars budget, and that we are on time.
Okay, so there are in So we're not going to be borrowing money, is what I'm hearing you say?
No additional money.
No additional money, okay. That's all I have, thank you.
Shamus?
Thank you. Mr. Marshall?
Yes, sir.
The city code was amended back in 2008 to require that any proceeds from the sale of school building, of surplus property, go back to schools. Even though it's a nominal amount, that's what happened in this deal, isn't it?
There's no sale, it's a lease. And the ordinance is very specific as to sale. So under the lease, because it's a lease, there's no reason, there's no requirement that money go to schools for this purpose.
Okay, so we're not conveying the West Hampton school site to the EDA?
We are.
And are we doing it for a nominal amount?
$10, yes.
Are we working, or is the administration working on any plans regarding what the school would have received had it been an outright sale?
Do we have an estimate of what that might have been?
Well, just are we working on somehow trying to make the schools whole?
Yes, as we bring forward the budget, the new capital budget, we have a plan. Let me say it a different way. We work with the superintendent on identifying a plan that school would put forward for renovation of schools. Because we recognize that it will be years before the city can bring forward new schools, a number of new schools like we've done in over the past couple of years. Schools did two plans a couple of years ago. One, they put together a plan for building new schools in phase 1, 2, and 3. And then they also had a plan for major capital renovations of schools. So we've been working with the superintendent on the major capital renovations to look at new schools could be done next, or should be done next, based upon that plan. And as we bring forward our capital budgets, we'll begin putting money in the out years for maintenance of those facilities. It is very likely that that would exceed the amount of money that would come from West Hampton. In fact, it's almost a certainty.
Compared to the last administration, they put $37 million into, $14.7 million into schools capital needs. It looks like this administration, like Mr. Winslow pointed out, has put $170 million.
Yes.
So it's over 10 times more in the schools. When this ordinance was passed regarding money going to schools, not a lot of money was going to schools. And now you guys are saying that one of the things we need to consider is the fact that over 10 times more money is going towards the capital improvements in schools than prior years when this ordinance was put into effect.
Okay. It's not to say we don't recognize that we still have to put more money into schools' capital improvements.
Right. At the end of the lease for the EDA to Boss Quarters in 60 years or however many years, that property reverts back to the city.
At the end of the lease with Boss Quarters, should Boss Quarters ever stop leasing the land?
Right.
Then we would provide that EDA would return the land to the city. Yes.
And would we keep all that was on the land?
Yes.
Okay. Is the same thing basically true for the lease your property, the lease on the state? Eventually, when this lease ends, will the state get football fields and the building and everything?
It's the leasehold improvement, so generally that reverts to the landlord. And now, we are trying to negotiate the ability to buy the land from the state at some point in the future so that would not necessarily be what happens.
But at this point, that's...
It's very likely what happens, yes.
All right. One of the comments that I've received has been that Altria had to pay $10 million just for naming rights for the Landmark Theater. Why is Boss Quarters having to pay for naming rights, but also getting the deal at West Hampton? Does anything going on in the East End have, is this one of the situations where you have to compare it to the global scheme instead of dividing it up into parts.
Right. This deal is greater than some of the parts, so that's where we look at it. But for, one of the things that the mayor insisted on was making sure that the East End didn't lose medical facilities. Vons Court agreed to that some time ago. They said they would expand those facilities, and this is a kind of grand bargain. All these pieces fit together. So that's the way that has to be viewed. But that's the way we believe that's the way it should be.
One of the other issues, I don't know, one of the other issues I've gotten is, if we didn't do this deal, we wouldn't have to move the money around from the schools, from the jail project, et cetera. But basically what you're saying, that is money we could save. If we save that money, instead of reallocating it towards this deal, would the fiscal impact compared to the loss of what we not have by having the Redskins here be greater or worse than just saving this money instead of reallocating it?
Okay.
Do you want me to restate?
I mean, let me make sure I understand what you're asking. The $10 million we proposed to use to loan as a loan, if we did not lend that money, could we have saved it?
Right. I mean, we wouldn't spend it. If we're on task on everything, then the school still would need it because they've got what they need this coming year. The jail project's on track, doesn't need it. We could have saved that money and either renewed the bonds or what have you that would provide for us to save that money.
Well, I think what would have happened is we just would have borrowed less money, long term debt.
Mm-hmm.
Or roll that capacity into a future year. Ultimately, all of this money is going to get spent.
Let me interject something. This point right here, in my opinion, the fact that we have the money set, it will not be used. If we take that money and use it, it will provide income. That money could not provide whilst it's sitting there. So that's my understanding of it. That would be a very sound use of that money that's sitting there. It's not going to get used until later days.
If we use the money on a jail or a school, let's say we had to spend it this year, it would complete those projects. If we use the money, but we don't need it for this year, if we use the money as a loan to spur economic development, then there is a payback for the city, and that is $40,000+ in taxes each year, as well as all ancillary benefits from the 200+ jobs.
So at the end of the day, saving money doesn't bring as much money into the city as spending it on this deal to bring in more money.
Correct.
Okay. The only other question, well, I have two other questions. In some of my discussions with folks at the state, they suggested that developers are very interested in the leasing site anyway, either mixed use or for residential. Obviously, I don't want to use a softball question. Why is this better than just letting it become apartments or condos or, Target?
I can't say there's much. What I can say is that you would not get a residence. This is a site, of all sites they looked at, they thought was most beneficial to their product.
And then the last one is, I think, hopefully I can say without getting myself confused. There's, for the sale of city-owned real estate, whether it's surplus or not, there's a solicited process and an unsolicited process. I think I've got an unsolicited process going on in my district right now, not too far from here, where if somebody came to the city and said, we'd like to buy this property. With a 60-year lease plus rights to renew, did we go out to Bon Secours? Did Bon Secours come to us and say, we're interested in the naming rights, the visible, we want to do to get it? How is this unsolicited versus solicited?
We talked to them about the Lee Street site. And they said, we're interested, but we'd be a lot more interested if the West Hampton site were included. That would secure the deal for us. We do this, Lee Street site, and the East End all together as a package.
Without
so unsolicited.
without the West Campus site, is this deal moving forward? Well, I guess really I should ask Sponsor Board tonight.
You should.
I'll ask that.
Other questions, okay?
Yeah, the question is, Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Connors. Thank you, Mr. Marshall. Let me ask a question differently. Is it possible for this deal to work without the West Hampton part of the deal?
I think that question should be directed towards Sponsor Board. Are you asking me?
I'm asking from the city perspective. Is it possible for us to do this deal, the East Street and the East End piece of the deal without the West End?
If we had a sponsor who was willing to pay $6.3 million at the lease site, yes.
I mean, so am I to understand that in order for the city to do this deal without a sponsor?
We have paid $6.3 million.
Which is in addition to the loan that we're doing for the building, or is that included in the team?
If you chose not to do a loan, but to fund it rather than finance it, you'd issue $6.3 or $8.8 million worth of bonds and papers, and then use debt service year over year to pay it off.
And if did we do an analysis of doing it from that perspective?
We did not, because it was pretty clear that having someone else pay the debt versus us paying the debt made a lot more sense. That no real analysis needed to be done.
And I appreciate that. Oh. Just saying, these are the kind of questions that people want to explore as to whether or not there is a more reasonable way to cut the deal, you know. Nowadays, you know, once you buy something, you can always decide whether or not you should have gotten something red instead of blue.
It's called Byron's abortion, right?
Yeah, or something like that. I appreciate the presentation, and we have all received a lot of questions, and a lot of what if this and what if that. There has also been a question raised as to why is not the Redskins, what is it costing the state to keep the Redskins here? Who else is contributing to the cost of the Redskins staying in Virginia?
As far as I know, Loudoun County and the state are both contributing money to keep the Redskins in the state. Is it forming? So we know it's $4 million from the state, and allows the county to provide $500,000 a year. I don't know how many years.
The trigger here was was if we sold the land. We looked at it from selling land or leasing land, see which way the deal was. The deal didn't work if we sold it. There were a lot of issues associated with it.
Let's follow that.
In terms of time, I'm sorry, it's not politics.
No, let's follow that track.
Okay.
Follow that track. And help me understand how it's such a great deal for us when we know it's a pretty good deal for Bob Sakura, who otherwise would have had to purchase that land. At around $7 million. I think this figure I've heard.
There have been a lot of figures out there.
All right, $5 to $7 million is what I'm hearing. Which is close to the amount we're going to lend them to do the development on these streets. And so now we're going to lend them close to that amount that they otherwise would have paid anyway if they had to purchase the West Hampton property. That sounds like a pretty good deal that would draw anybody in. Otherwise, they're looking at having to pay $14 million. One to purchase the property at West Hampton, and another $7 million, if it's that number, to develop the leasee property as a part. Now, we then ask, well, what would be the incentive for Bond to Cook if they had to pay for both of them? I see why they would take the deal. I don't see why we would take the deal. Help me understand, what is the benefit to the public in this deal?
Okay, I'll try. One, when you look at the appraised, the assessed value of the land at West Hampton, that assessed value includes the building at over $5 million, as well as all of the land. A, Bonds Corp is not proposing to take all the land. Right. Fields don't go. B, that building is not worth $5 million. Whoever comes to deal with that building is going to have to do significant renovations to it, if it can be renovated. I'm assuming it can be renovated. So, they would have a development, developer site, they were leased from the developer, therefore they would end up paying the property taxes to us. Similarly, in the East End, they would be paying property taxes. So the only oddity would be the site at, behind the science museum, they would agree to pay, pay for lower taxes.
Has or can these benefits to the taxpayer been monetized and summarized in a way that we can understand?
Yes, and it's over $400,000 a year. It's about, it's like somewhere around $450,000 between the three sites. And over 10 years, that's $4.5 million.
How much?
$4.5 million. And taxes, those are taxes to the city. They're, that's not other taxes like income tax to the state based upon the $20 million annual payroll.
Well, I hear the talk of these jobs. There's no guarantee that, A, these jobs are going to come to residents of Richmond in any significant guarantee. A, but B, we don't get payroll taxes off of jobs. And so we need some kind of monetization projection as to what those jobs actually mean. Sounds good, but we've got no guarantees of capturing those funds. And if so, we get them off meals taxes and what have you. We don't have income tax on paper.
Well, in addition to the property tax, they would pay legal tax and grocery taxes. So they will pay taxes based upon their earnings at the site.
Can you present to this council a monetarized summary of the tax benefit for this deal to the public?
We can give you an estimate based upon the number of employees, based upon A, the estimated value of the construction, B, the type of businesses that they say they bring, C, the number of employees and the average salary of those employees. Yes, we can then extrapolate what the taxes are.
And taking into account that they will not all be city residents employed.
We can't guarantee that they will all be city residents.
Okay, I'm just saying, just taking that into account. Yeah.
So our
feel is more important than what those kids need and those teachers need to operate it. Times are saying, so it's an exciting prospect. I just think we're out of round with our problems.
Okay.
That's all up.
We have other questions from council members. Okay, Mr. Trammell.
Mr. Marshall. I've had so many phone calls since 3 a.m. this morning. These citizens are very upset about this deal. Now they're saying that it's not fair that we should make bonds support the value of the building, not basically give it to them like we did at the Crestar deal back in the day. They're just upset. They're like, why can't we sell it to them? And I know you said that we're not, we're just leasing it to them. But they're saying, the citizens, a lot of them saying that quite sure they want that on their conscience that they target our children in the Richmond public schools. By not buying the building for $7 million, especially when it's been in the paper that now, I guess the school board is now short of like $17 million and not $10 million. And I think Kathy said the other day in the paper that, you know, there's not that kind of money to just hand over to them.
What I'd like to do, if you don't mind, is first have Jane Farrar talk about how the building, how she would value the building as a real estate professional. And then we can talk about if we got that amount of money, what would be the impact on the student and on the school's budget.
Thank you.